Welcome everybody. I hope you're all fine and doing well. Today we continue with the build of the Takom King Tiger Initial, the prototype V1 with its test turret. Okay, this episode is about the painting and starting the baseline for weathering, tracks and vehicle of course. Last episode we built the whole thing in the best way I possibly can, yet still increasing skill here. My weld seams look funny and I had to refill some of the locator marks and sand them a second time after I primed the whole thing with Mr. Surfacer 1200. I did most of this off camera, just the fixing of what was left over from the last episode, but now let's get into the painting. You're watching Tank Brusher. I'm doing 1/35th scale German armor on mostly a weekly basis, so thanks for subscribing. Now let's dive into it. Okay, we get four different color layouts called out in the manual, and three of them are pretty much the same, so I don't really get the point. But yeah, they are not too far off. This RAL 7028 dark yellow is a thing. This Panzer Grey RAL 7021, not so much. That's based on a recolorated or original color photograph from 1945, and they look grayish on it, or this one looks a little bit grayish. I would go for a green, to be honest, but that's speculation. Okay, base coat in German dark gray, not for this color being German dark gray, but for getting a gray that allows some contrast in the shadow area for the weathering and still is not looking too wrong or looks still familiar. I mask off the start and the end of the gun. Okay, the muzzle brake gets the red oxide primer in the color call out, and I would like to explore this down this road. The rest of the vehicle completely pre-painted in red oxide primer. That's just me doing this. I just like the effect. And then when the RAL 7028 dark yellow is on there, I think this looks good. I use the AK Real Color series together with the Mr. Hobby leveling thinner. I think this gives the best surface quality I can get out of my airbrush, together with this really hard surface a lacquer paint creates, so I don't rub away the paint by using my fingers, by touching the model, as it happens often with acrylic paints. This time I go for cream white for the color modulation, or just a little bit the edge highlighting. I usually do this using oil paints, but this time I'm after a short drying time, so using the airbrush and acrylics a little bit more often serves the same purpose. I tried only to hit the edges and blend it very, very fine. This white should not create too much contrast, should not get too bright. I'm just after what I would usually do with the oil paints, as I said, and I'm not going for a full-blown color modulation, just brightening up the surface, making it look a little bit more interesting. Compared to the method using oils, it's a trade-off, drying time versus control, of course, but still the level of control an airbrush provides, or a good quality airbrush provides, is good enough to get through this step quite easily. And the difference is good visible and helps a lot to break up this vast even surface with the German dark yellow with nothing going on. But now let's move on, have a look into the decals. Yeah, they are not as bad as the instructions were, but they are still not on top of Takom's game. I have no problems with the film or the quality of the decal itself, but you will see what the problem is very shortly. To avoid some silvering or reflection, different reflections, I lay down a nice and even coat of semi-gloss and place the decals on top of it the same way you place a decal. And here is the problem. Again, they did not communicate well enough the dimensions of the decals for the toying points. They are just too wide. We have to trim them left and right. And on the other side, this damaged my decal a little bit. Semi-gloss coat on top of it to avoid silvering. And to be honest, I have no problems hacking away on a model kit. I designed two 3D printed conversion kits before, and modifying this in order to get a really, really rare vehicle out of it, I have no problems. But I have a problem with manufacturers being that lazy with the instructions and the decals. I'm kind of upset here a little bit with the kit so far. But well, I could have plotted my own, so didn't do it. Let's keep it positive, move on to the road wheel assembly. They are fitting relatively loose, so I decided really late into the build to make a sandwich out of them using a two-component epoxy called Green Stuff, quite a fitting name, together with some CA glue. Yeah, just sandwiching them on top of each other and then adjusting them accordingly so everything is still lining up, enabling still the tooth of the tracks, the guide horns, to interlock in the road wheels. And looking back, it's not the best idea to do this on a King Tiger. There are only two layers of interleaving road wheels, so we can easily handle them by themselves, I think. Once the whole thing is tried, a small lever is required to get them off the swing arms, and there are no real issues with this whatsoever. It's just reducing the amount of components we have to deal with. Now I have something new to show you. This is the Everlasting Wet Palette by Redgrass Games, and I use this from now on to lay out my acrylic paints when I do the detail painting and the early stages of the weathering for the complete vehicle. It keeps the paint fresh and allows for easier mixing, but this is something I would like to talk about in a separate video. From now, here is only the detail painting. For example, the crease points are painted red. This is something not often seen when doing scale models, but in many cases, especially the prototypes or training vehicles, had this feature. And then moving on into highlighting the bolts and details on this running gear sandwich. The smaller, the brighter the detail, I think, was the summary of what Night Shift said about it. And this is what I do here, basically the same, just getting them a little bit more color into it. And again, with the wet palette, it's quite easy to control the amount of paint on the brush to get this done in a really fast way and without too much spillage. For the road wheels or the contact surface to the tracks, I went for black metal from Vallejo. And now I go in with a natural steel, is the hue called. It's a brighter version of the metal color, just highlighting the outer edges. That's about the same we would do using a graphite pen later in the weathering, and I will do it to enhance it further. Now, at the same time, when I paint the details, I go for some brush chipping using mix chipping color, but the whole chipping process around the vehicle will be part of the next episode. Here it was just a matter of having the component in my hand once and being able to finish the acrylic paints on it at once. Doing this more often now, I can already tell you it's a matter of the quality of the tip of the brush and how well you can maintain the flow of paint to get a good result, aside from the compositional choices, but this is something more advanced we have to talk of later. For the drive sprocket, I only go for chipping the top of the teeth. And if you build a more used vehicle with these kind of tracks, you can slightly undercut every second tooth because the tracks were not evenly spaced and there was abrasion going on. But the photos I use for building my V1 are somewhat clean in this area, so I didn't go for this effect. For now, it's the brown wash for German dark yellow, applied on the surface, moistened with enamel odorless thinner to avoid tight marks and speed up the cleanup process, of course. And you can see I already chipped some of the road wheels, get a little bit more effect going on where the transitional area is between the silver or metal coat and the German dark yellow. And this is what they look now. I can start the weathering on them in the next episode. And the difference is quite obvious, I think. Into the tracks! I painted them in XF63, so I can use a black or a dark wash on them. The black wash creates some additional shadows in the recessed areas, and on top of the raised surface, it works like a glaze. My goal is to create some variation in the surface, not making a specific color to stand out, but creating a little bit a natural effect. And dark wash was the first step. And you can already see a difference. It's now a washed surface with much more shadow and much more depth. Same is done on the other side, but here it is more a filter as a wash. It's the same product, of course, but it's a different application or a different technique, if you want to call it that way. Okay, that's only the second layer of this effect, and since it's a fitting point, we step over to the barrel. I highlighted it using a little bit a more grayish tone in the middle section, just to create some additional highlight, make it fit with the highlighted German dark yellow, and of course then the dark wash is used as a glaze. I spread it as evenly as I can possibly do over the complete black surface, creating this a little bit alternated surface. It looks a little bit sprinkly, and once the shininess is gone, it will take good effect, but more on this on next episode. In the meantime, the tracks have dried and I'm now dusting them using the airbrush and a buff or relatively bright dust color with the airbrush. That's an acrylic paint in this case, of course, creating a second base coat for an additional wash, further alternating the surface. Both sides are dealt with, and it's really important to only dust the surface, not repaint it. I don't want to lose all the effect from the wash and the dark gray, but still creating spots where a different colored wash can now create contrast on. The brighter your surface, the higher the impact of your wash in this case. And yeah, just apply track wash and you immediately see this is much too saturated. This turns the whole surface completely brown. And this is not what I was after. I use my large brush here, only enamel odorless thinner on it, and I spread out the enamel wash I used, make it thin, make it just look like there was some rust, surface rust going on. And there's still a debate about if these casted tracklings, if they were primed from the factory or not. Only thing I can tell you is that casted metal does not look as a unified surface. It's not a machined surface. And I have images on my Flickr account. You can click this in the channel up above. There are images of casted metals and a lot of textured I photographed on my local steelworks. Compared to the tracks, fruel model tracks that were rusted using a burnishing liquid, I don't think they are too similar yet, but it's already going in the right direction. So this is something I would like to explore more, go deeper on it. With tracks, road wheels and barrel mounted, the whole thing looks somewhat started, but it's not going far enough to end the video here. So I would like to proceed with the pinwash, the first step in my weathering process. It's easily the most important effect, and it's in about every video. So I will show you a little bit more about how I apply it instead of just showing off a pinwash. I always moisten the surface, and I use this enamel odorless thinner for it. I think this is a turpentine oil, a well refined one. It's not a mineral spirit, not an alcohol, for example. And this moistening of the surface means just using a damp brush and getting a layer of this oil on top of the surface, not completely draining it. Okay, and why do I moisten the surface? It's relatively simple. This does a lot for me, because if you have the same liquid on the surface as you have in the brush, you greatly reduce the capillary action. These enamel washes, they get spread over the complete surface really fast, especially when your base coat is flat and not perfectly, has some sparkles in it, whatever, some careless paint applied. You immediately stain the complete surface. This film of enamel odorless thinner keeps or reduces this effect. You can see here when I apply my wash, I don't get tight marks in this cases. I only have to clean up the points where I applied the wash with my brush, and this is easily done using a second brush that is clean and only has only some enamel odorless thinner on it. So it's really going fast, this complete pin wash. All around the vehicle it's about 15 to 20 minutes. So in summary, pre-moistening these surfaces helps reducing time wasted on the cleanup process. It makes the cleanup process more easy, and it contains the spread of the wash when applied. But now I would like to end this here and start with the weathering in the next and the last episode. We have to use a lot of oils and fool around with mud and dust and dirt deposits and fuel spillage effects, all the good stuff. So I see you next time. I hope you enjoyed the video. I'm Tank Brusher. Thanks for subscribing. See you next time. Happy modeling!